A while back, I made a Twitter bot to fight internet scams. Basically, it takes the URL of a website as the input and scans the provided URL to check whether it is a scam or a legitimate website. I also made the bot open source so that people can contribute to it to make the application more efficient in detecting scams. In this video, I demonstrate an SQL injection vulnerability that I found in my application and how I managed to exploit it. Disclaimer, this video is only intended for educational purposes and to educate developers about what can go wrong in their projects. Before moving on with the video, I'd like to thank adapti.io for sponsoring this video. As a developer, I understand how hard it is to implement in-app subscriptions and purchases in your app. You'll have to write the code for your subscription model yourself, and if you want to make changes to this model sometime in the future, you'll have to make changes again and push new versions of your app. It's all a little bit complicated, but it doesn't have to be. With adapti.io, you can integrate in-app subscriptions in your app in less than an hour. That's right. Using their free SDK, which is available for multiple frameworks, you can create paywalls and seamlessly add products that you want to sell in your application. One thing I love about Adapti is that you can easily sync your subscriptions between your web app and your mobile apps with the web SDK. You can also view the analytics of your app's revenue, MRR, active subscriptions, expired subscriptions, etc. from your Adapti dashboard. Adapti is an N1 alternative of RevenueCat, and you can start using Adapti for absolutely free of cost. You only have to pay once you start making more than $10,000 per month from your app. Adapti also has a knowledge base which helps you increase your app's revenue with multiple strategies. For example, Adapti offers an A/B testing feature using which you can create multiple paywalls in your application and test which one works well with your users and hence understand what your users prefer, which enables you to increase your app's revenue. So go check out Adapti and start integrating paywalls in your application for both iOS and Android for absolutely free of cost. The link will be in the description below, so go ahead, give it a try. This morning, I was going through my bot's code to make some minor changes, and then I found this particular line. Well, it's simply an SQL query which is used to retrieve some values from the database. SQL is a language that can be used to communicate with database servers to perform operations on the data, like reading data, writing new data, updating existing data, deleting data, etc. In this case, this function is used to check if the URL that is given as input is already scanned before by checking if it exists in the database. Notice how the parameter URL that is being passed to this query is unsanitized, meaning that it is not processed before passing to the SQL statement. And this is a terrible practice. You should never ever pass unsanitized user-controlled data into an SQL query like this, because it may result in a vulnerability called SQL injection, which you might have already heard about. The basic concept of SQL injection is that an attacker can craft special inputs that will be included blindly in the backend SQL queries of the vulnerable application by the application itself. This results in the attacker being able to modify the hard-coded SQL query in the application's code to literally anything he wants. And this enables the attacker to do things like accessing sensitive details in the database, like the passwords of other users, deleting data from the database, or even compromising the whole application server and taking full control of it. Obviously, this is bad. So I know I had to fix it as soon as possible. But before writing a fix for this, I wanted to exploit this vulnerability myself to see how a potential attacker might approach this and up to what extent it can be exploited. Will I be able to snatch full access to the server with this vulnerability? Or is it just limited to dumping the database? Or is it even possible to exploit it? Oh, and one more thing. I have this free course on SQL injection for beginners. It's a 2-hour course and you can go ahead and enroll in it for absolutely free of cost. It covers everything that you need to know about SQL injection, and it also includes hands-on training. So I suggest you go ahead and check it out. The link will be in the description below and also in the suggested cards below. It'll be really helpful to understand what I'm about to show in this video. Anyway, so I immediately spawned up a local instance of my application on my virtual machine and started testing. I began by writing a test function so that I can give inputs to the bot from the code itself instead of posting a tweet on twitter.com for every new input. I also added a logging statement that logs the output of the SQL query into the application's log file. It just makes the testing easier as I can simply check the logs to see if my SQL injection worked. So this is my first payload. I started with a single quote in my input to close the existing single quote in the hard-coded query. And then I say or 1 equal to 1. By using the or operator to include this condition that always returns true, will make the query return all the rows from the table. And you can also notice how I did not close the quote for the second one. This is because there already exists an unclosed single quote in the hard-coded query, which will close the quote in our input. Perfect. Oh, and one more thing. We cannot have spaces in our payload because there is a rejects check that is made which extracts only the string that match the pattern of a URL. And URLs don't have spaces. Ideally, I would bypass this by URL encoding the spaces, but that wouldn't work as well because the URL is not being decoded anywhere in the code. So I did some research and I found out that you can actually escape spaces by using comments. So I replaced the spaces in my payload with empty comments like this. All right, now let me test my bot with my first malicious input, also called as a payload. In the logs, you can see the results the SQL query returned. And it returned all the records from the table, which means it worked. My SQL injection payload worked. Now I know that this vulnerability is exploitable in this application. I can now dump the whole database, but it really contains nothing interesting from an attacker's perspective because there is simply no sensitive data stored in the database. So the first thing that came into my mind is to use the sleep function of MySQL to make the application sleep for certain seconds, certain amount of time. And if it works, this will be a huge impact on the app because an attacker can potentially make my application sleep for an infinite amount of time, thus making it completely unresponsive to other users. But in order to use the sleep function, I have to include it in a separate select query. There is an operator called union using which I can combine two select statements together. But there is a condition. The select statement on the left of the union operator must return the same number of columns as the select statement on the right of the union operator. Now, I know that the left select statement gets all the columns from the scans table. And I also know the schema of this scans table. There are 6 columns in this table and this select statement returns all these 6 columns. So the right select statement in my payload must also contain 6 columns. So this is how my payload goes. Single quote, union, select 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm just selecting the first 6 numbers to match the number of columns. And I will now replace one of the number with my sleep function that sleeps for, let's say, 5 seconds. And this is the final query that will be executed when my payload is included in the hard-coded SQL query. Let's see if it works. Well, I guess it's safe to say that it actually worked. The application slept for 5 seconds as instructed in the payload. I can change this payload to make it sleep for like 1000 seconds and it would still work, making the application completely unresponsive. Now for the final part. Can I fully take over the server with this vulnerability? Will I be able to get a reverse shell or something like that? Short answer, no. Or at least I didn't find a way to do so. But there is one thing that I found which is really interesting. It is probably the most interesting of all the things that we have done so far. You see, using the inbuilt function of MySQL called loadFile, I can read files from a MySQL select query, provided of course that the MySQL user on the server has permissions to read that file. First, I tried reading the /etc/password file because the MySQL user has permissions to read it. So I can introduce the loadFile function into my write select statement, just like how I did with my sleep function. But wait, even though we managed to exploit this and read the contents of the password file, how do we actually read it? I mean, sure, the contents of the file will be logged to the log file, but an attacker wouldn't have access to this log file, right? We only have access to it because we are running a local instance of the app on our own computer. If you come back to the actual vulnerable function that contains the SQL query, you can see that it is returning the fourth column from the results obtained from executing the query, which is nothing but the tweet ID. This tweet ID is then appended to this URL, which is then appended to the tweet text, and the tweet is then posted using Twitter API. So now I know where to introduce the load file function in my payload. It would be in the fourth column of my write select statement, which is where the tweet ID column would be. And this is my final payload. Let me test this payload on my bot by posting a tweet. What's this? You can see my entire payload is not being recognized as a URL by Twitter. And that would be a problem because my app is written in such a way that only a URL will be extracted from the tweet and then that URL will be processed. Hence my payload will just be ignored because it's not part of the URL. But fortunately, or should I say unfortunately, my bot also supports a feature where you can use HTTPZ instead of HTTPS. And if you use HTTPZ, Twitter will not treat your URL as a URL because it's not a valid protocol. I have put this feature in place because sometimes Twitter doesn't allow you to tweet certain URLs. And in those cases, you can just replace the S in HTTPS with a Z to be able to tweet at my bot with whatever URL you want to scan. But oh boy, I never imagined that this feature would actually allow someone to exploit a vulnerability. Anyway, I now replace HTTPS with HTTPZ and post it and wait for the response from my bot. But I never get a response. I checked my logs and I saw that the /etc/password file is read successfully, but the tweet failed to post because it exceeds the maximum allowed characters in a tweet, which is 280. All right, new problem. What do I do now? It actually didn't take much time for me to figure out how to bypass this. I can use the hex MySQL function to encode the file contents into hex format so that when it gets appended to the URL in the response, the whole thing will be treated as a URL and the maximum allowed characters in a URL are 2083, which is good enough for this exploit to work. So let me try again, but this time I will use the hex function along with the load file function. And look at that. We got a response from the bot. If I hover over the URL, you can see there are many hex characters. So did it actually work? Let's find out. I will copy the link address and then select everything after /statuses and then decode this hex. And look at that. That is my password file, which contains information about all the users in my server. In the same way, I will also try to read the .env file from my projects directory, which contains the Twitter and Google API keys of my bot. I simply change the path in the payload to my .env file and post the tweet in the same way. I wait for the response and here it is. Now I decode the hex and here are my Twitter and Google API keys. Well, not anymore. I will have to revoke these obviously and generate new ones. So obviously, I will make the necessary changes to the code to remove this vulnerability before posting this video. Many people associate SQL injections with only web applications, but they can exist in any type of application. And this is indeed the reason for this vulnerability to exist in my application in the first place. I simply did not consider the possibility of an SQL injection in this kind of project. So do not make the same mistake as me. Always sanitize your user inputs before passing them to SQL queries. Or even better, use prepared statements or object relational models. They will prevent SQL injections in your application. So thanks for watching this video. I hope you liked it and I hope you did learn something new. If you did like this video, please do not forget to leave a thumbs up below and also comment in the comment section. If you're not yet a subscriber, please do hit that subscribe button and also turn on the bell icon to receive instant updates from my channel. Also check out Adaptee, the sponsors of this video. The link will be in the description below. I'll see you in the next video. Until then, cheers.